We are taking you now to Antarctica. Not literally, of course, but picture it, the world's coldest continent. But here's the thing, much like the rest of the planet, it is heating up and heating up fast. The finger of blame pointed at climate change. New data from the scientific community on Antarctic research highlights some of the devastating consequences of global warming. Taking a look at our atmosphere, by 2100, less than 80 years away, the atmosphere is forecasted to heat up by as much as 3.6 degrees Celsius. With our oceans in that same time frame, the southern oceans warming up by potentially 1.75 degrees Celsius. Antarctic ice melt may see sea levels rise globally by up to 2 meters before the century's out. And marine life, they're bearing the brunt, with emperor penguin populations expected to decline close to extinction. It's pretty scary stuff. And the lead author from the report, Stephen Chown, joins us now from Berlin, where he's delivering the findings of that report. Stephen, we really appreciate your time this morning. Thank you so much for joining us. I think we keep feeling, acting as if we should be surprised by this information, and yet here it is continuing to slap us in the face.
Yes, in fact, that was something mentioned today, is the first IPCC report, which was the first assessment report of fire, was in 1990. We've had 32 years of messages saying this is coming at you, and now the messages are it's really coming at you quickly, and the window is closing. There's time, but the urgency is now really significant.
So let's talk about this new report. Can you hit us with the main points of most concern? We mentioned some of the issues in that introduction. What's of most concern to you?
There are two aspects to this. The first is the global aspect. So if you melted all the ice on Antarctica, that's 58 meters of sea level rise. That's not going to happen. But there's locked in the contribution from Antarctica means that we could see, as you pointed out, up to 2 meters of sea level rise. Now, that's really hard to imagine for some people, because you think of the coast, you think 2 meters is not very much. But with just 40 centimeters, and you can measure that on your desk at home, it's not really very much at all. That turns what should be a 100-year flood event into an annual coastal flood event. And that's the expectation already under business-as-usual scenarios. So we're dramatically changing the way the world will work. There will be hundreds of millions of people that will be displaced as a consequence if we don't actually get on top of our emissions and reduce them rapidly. So that's the global message. The local one is, well, we're going to see essentially Antarctic and polar life fall off the ends of the earth. Tropical species can move to where it's cooler, but species that really need the cold have got nowhere to go. So we're on this path. We've set out on a path to change a world that is just fantastic for all of us by losing all of those species.
You know, you talk about the sea level rises, and by God, have we noticed that here in New Zealand. I can count about 6 or 7 significant flooding events we've had here in New Zealand over the past kind of 8 to 12 months. Those events, as you say, that would usually be considered 1 in 100 year events. Considering how close New Zealand is to Antarctica in proximity compared to the rest of the world, should we be particularly concerned about what is happening in that part of the world?
I don't understand New Zealand's situation fully, but of course you have subsidence as well as sea level rise, so those two make a real difference. But looking across the world, sea level works very strangely. So, for example, if you lose a lot of ice mass off Greenland, that sort of shifts as water to the south, you lose a lot of Antarctica, it tends to balance off into the north. So I think the position for everybody is actually try not to lose the ice. You really don't want to be getting rid of the cryosphere, because that has bad implications for everyone. I would say that New Zealand, because of the subsidence as well as the sea level rise, has some significant concerns, and I think those have already been raised.
I was reading part of the report in terms of what the issues are around the Southern Ocean warming, and it says that the ocean becomes more acidic and it starts losing oxygen. Can you talk to us about the impact of that and what exactly that means, Stephen?
Well, of course, as all of us know, you don't have oxygen as an animal. It's pretty hard to make a go of things. And in marine systems, as soon as you lose oxygen, you end up having very little life there at all. In fact, we already elsewhere know that they're dead zones where there's very little oxygen at all and there's simply no life. So deoxygenating the ocean is a really bad idea by warming it up. And of course, carbon dioxide, everybody thinks about climate change as warming as a consequence of the greenhouse, the enhanced greenhouse effect. But that carbon dioxide dissolves in the ocean, and it does so in the Southern Ocean particularly, and there are species there that are very sensitive to having acidic waters. Their shells are built out of calcium carbonate, basically, and they're dissolving. It impacts their life histories. And of course, these organisms like plankton, like krill, that are sensitive, form the basis of the marine food web. So in effect, through them, one's altering all the iconic things we've come to know and appreciate. Albatrosses, penguins, seals, all krill feeders and feeders on plankton will be substantially affected as a consequence.
Gosh, it's big stuff, Stephen. And you are in, as I mentioned, Berlin right now, delivering this report to the parties to the Antarctic Treaty meeting. What is it that you're calling for? What is it that you're trying to achieve there?
There are two clear messages from this. The first is that there has to be real urgency of action. So the Antarctic Treaty parties are responsible for the continental region, and they can actually implement action to see to local conservation of the species that are there. But they also have a real obligation to talk to their governments about getting emissions down, because what's good for Antarctica is actually good for everywhere else. Mm. So that's a really clear message, is get emissions down and get them down quickly. The second message is we can't afford to live with such significant uncertainty about what's going to happen over the next, say, 100 years. Could it be 40 centimeters of sea level rise or 2 meters? And the second message is invest in the kinds of work that's required to ensure that civil society and governments can make more informed decisions. In other words, the research work that's required. So those are the two key messages, and they have both a global imprint and a local Antarctic imprint.
Stephen, we so appreciate your expertise this morning and your insight into what's going on in a really major part of the world. So thank you for your time this morning. That's Professor Stephen Chown, the Director of Securing Antarctica's Environmental Future. And all the best in Berlin.
Thank you.